Welcome to School Talk. I'm Nadja Varney, your host. Can we or should we teach nonviolence? Well, just reading or listening to the news and a few words from our nation's collective memory will highlight the importance of this discussion. Words like Jonesboro and Columbine and Virginia Tech, so much violence. Can we or should we teach nonviolence? Well, my guests today respond with an enthusiastic yes. From the Institute for the Study and Practice of Nonviolence, the Executive Director, Teny Gross, will join me now, and later, Pam Steager, who works with schools in Providence, Rhode Island, will join us. Welcome, Teny Gross.
Thanks for having me back.
Well, it's been quite a few years, actually, since you were on before.
Yeah.
And I know a little bit about your background, and when you first came into Rhode Island with these great ideas, no money, no power, and now you have built this wonderful institute. So tell us first, whatever made you interested in dealing with nonviolence?
I think it was a surprising journey. It was really a series of accidents. I'm an Israeli. My mother was a Serb. My dad was a Croat. I served in the Israeli army. And coming to the United States, I really couldn't ignore what's going on, I thought, in levels of violence that surprised me. It's actually safer to grow up in Israel than it is in the United States. I think being taught by Elie Wiesel and being sensitive to literature and my neighbors, you sort of feel like, are you going to do something about it? That's an eternal question we all ask ourselves. We live once. What are you going to do about the issues that burn in your heart? And that's the issue that I care about.
And you certainly have moved it forward. So before we get right into it, I'm wondering, where all this violence came from and what's happening to our culture. So I have something here I'd like to read. I mean, in my own opinion, it seems like, if you'll excuse the pun, like overkill. Everywhere you look, there's more violence, and not just violence. I used to like Murder, She Wrote, because it was a mystery. But now they put the camera on for a long time. Commercials have a little 1 minute, frame, or 5 seconds. But you'll see 15 seconds or more on the blood and the gore and explosions. So I'm just going to read just a sentence from Steve Almond, who wrote in the Boston Globe, Our Addiction to Violence. He's an author and coming out with a new collection of essays. But he was talking here about the fact that we are awash in fictional commodities which happily exploit our willingness to view violence as nothing more than entertainment. Actually, I'm going to read this part. He says, if we're honest with ourselves, after all, aren't we rooting for Tony Soprano to work out his problems in therapy? No, we want to see him whack somebody, period. But then he says, we're not showing the real death and destruction. And he said, he's suggesting a more subtle and pervasive psychic shift in this country, awash in artificial renderings. And they're not seeing the emotional consequences of violence. I'm just, that's in part. So is our culture changing? Are we becoming desensitized to all this?
Just in the short time that I lived here, since 89, the three main TV channels I've seen a shift. It used to be that weekend programming was different. Now it's police dramas. 7 days a week now, basically ABC, NBC, and CBS have something with CSI, something with murder, something with violence. It's got to have an effect. It's a menu. Our diet affects our health. Our mental diet affects our health. So it's always on TV now, everywhere. There's a lot of violence. And that does have an effect. I also agree that it's not the reality. It's sort of an addiction. It doesn't give us the reality of it. When our street workers and myself have to be in a hospital with a mother and father who just lost their son, that's something, we're traumatized by driving to the hospital, right? This is nothing anyone wants to experience. Mm-hmm. And yet we consume it on TV every night. I don't watch any of those TV programs. People, I said, don't you watch 24? And I said, absolutely not. I live in a violent society, try and fix violent society. It doesn't entertain me at all. It saddens me.
Mm-hmm. And you only mentioned the major broadcast outlets, but if you look through all the cable stations and the video games, and people get angry at our students and young people who are violent, but I say it's the adults who are making money, you know, feeding this into their minds. Although that's not the whole story, right. I realize that. And thinking about what follows from that, you mentioned guns and cop stories. Well, there's this debate over guns, you know, and the availability of lethal weapons to kids or anyone. And there's two sides. I read research. One person wrote, yes, you know, and I won't bother to read the research, but I was looking for research. And then someone in the Minnesota State Department of Corrections did their own study. It's not a factor. The guns are not. It just mirrors the homicide of the day. But you are an institute for the study of nonviolence as well, right, as practice. So would you give us an overview of what your research is showing?
I mean, the availability of guns is a problem. You know, it is a problem. A lot of incidents. You're looking at 14 to 16,000 homicides a year in the United States. 25 years period, you had about 580,000 homicides. 10 Vietnam wars. Northern Ireland is the only other place in the last 25 years that had a similar per capita homicide
Where
rate.
Where was that?
Northern Ireland.
Oh, Northern Ireland.
Right, they have a civil war.
Yes.
Right, that's what we resemble. We do not resemble any other country apart from countries in war. That's outstanding. We're exceptional in violence. And the availability of guns absolutely has an effect. I would always say that. I just don't need research. I mean, we look at research, there's all sides of it. Mm-hmm. But we do know that teenage years, you're hot-headed. You might go into a conflict. The availability of a gun. And the same thing, by the way, shows for suicides. You know, many of us get depressed. Teenage years are very emotional. You're not quite made out. You're not quite cooked. And as an adult, you have a gun. You'll take that to an irreversible length. So definitely the fact that guns are available and they're so lethal. It's hard also when we work on mediating situation. It is much, much harder to come back from a homicide than from a fist fight. If you kill a relative of mine, now to think about peace and let's reconcile is just a lot harder than it is if we just had even a really strong fist fight. Mm-hmm. So the tools do matter. I call the gun really the personal nuclear bomb, right? If you have two countries that are in conflict, they have two regular armies, the strong one, the weak country usually will not attack the stronger country. But if the smaller country has now a nuclear bomb, all bets are off. Right? If you're a strong boy and I'm a weaker boy, I'm usually not going to attack you. But if I have a gun now, all assessments of body size, courage, all those things are off. It's just a different thing now. We threw a nuclear option now into personal relationships. So it changed everything, the availability of guns.
What do you say to people, though, who say, well, if you limit guns, only the criminals who will get them anyway will have them, and I will be defenseless? People in the South love their guns, and mm-hmm. West, you know, they say this is just part of our culture. And I've heard people here in New England say, if somebody comes into my house, they better watch out, because I have a gun.
Right.
And that, to me, that's frightening, because number one, you're not going to be as good with that gun as a criminal who's been using it for 10 years. Mm-hmm. And how do you answer those people?
I mean, I don't. We don't have the research capacity that other organizations do, but what I've seen law enforcement and research groups do, it's pretty rare that someone actually defends themselves with a gun and successfully. You need to go to your cupboard, someone breaks in, the time responds, the amount of cost and accidents. So is that fear real? It is real on some level. Is it highlighted by the NRA? Of course it is. But in reality, I just don't think that is an answer. At the moment, it's true also, we just have so many guns out there that to take them back will be a difficulty. And taking the guns off is not the whole answer, too. Philadelphia, by November 16th of last year, took more than 5,000 guns off the streets. And homicides climbed over 400.
Oh, my goodness.
Providence method is different. Why we've been successful in two cities in Boston initially in the 90s and now in Providence is, guns also do symbolize, that's part of the argument of the NRA and part of arguments of people like me as well, is it does symbolize a certain conflict. There is some conflict. You don't just shoot anybody. And working on those conflicts is as important as getting the guns. So really just focusing on the gun,
right,
is not the complete answer.
Yes.
That is true.
That makes a lot of sense. And That leads me to ask, what is the basic philosophy that guides your work in nonviolence?
Relationships. It's not just that we're not a cult of nonviolence, right? There's relationships, young people, etc. Well, what leads you to act a certain way? Usually you've been hurt yourself. I mean, the statistics are all there, all the research are there about kids growing up, being hurt themselves, growing up in a very tough environment, seeing violence, being exposed to violence. Mm. So having caring adults is very important, whether it's boys and girls, the big brother, big sister, mentoring, being involved in young people's life is a very, very important in what they call in the research community protective factors. We get involved in the conflicts, you know, the anonymity, crime thrives in anonymity, so we get right involved in the conflicts. Who is fighting who? People really don't want to be shot or shoot someone. Most people don't. They don't feel they have an option. So getting involved in there, helping people save face, helping people express what their grief is with the other side, that's important work that we do. And indeed, last year, Providence, which is the third poorest city in the country for children, and it's the second biggest city in New England, experienced 50% drop in homicides, and no one under 20 was killed.
50% drop in homicides?
Yes.
And no one under 20 was killed. That's that's amazing, because I know in the past, statistics I've heard of Providence, you know, teenagers were being shot in kind of gangline fashion.
Yes, it's a tough city.
You say relationships. When you get involved, do you just do the police call you and you go to a scene? How does that work in just basically?
We have 13 street workers. Many of them were in the past involved in life of crime or grew up in very tough neighborhoods. They were some of them were former gang leaders. Some of them were involved with drugs. Some of them were involved in shooting. They care, but for some reason, or it's a complex journey, they turn their life around. They come from a very diverse group, as Cambodian, Laotian, a white guy who is in a wheelchair who was a victim of shooting by the Laotian gang, Hispanics, African-American, Cape Verdean, and they work as a team, they care. This is their communities to turn around.
That sounds so interesting. We have to take a break right now, but when we come back, I'd like to have Ms. Steager, Pam Steager, who works with the schools, join us. But let's continue this conversation about these relationships and how you really get involved and the kinds of people who are your street workers. Great. And then others are going into the schools.
That's right.
So let's hear about that. Stay with us. We'll be right back.
I'm sick of dealing with you.
I work 6 days a week.
Who do you think you are?
Don't you ever talk back to me again! You just shut up!
What are you crying about?
What?
What a child learns about violence, a child learns for life. Teach carefully. We can show you how. Act Against Violence. Call 877-ACT-WISE for a free brochure.
It's a joy now to welcome Teny Gross, is Pam Steager. And I believe Pam is the Director of Training at the Institute for the Study and Practice of Nonviolence in Providence, Rhode Island.
That's right.
Well, welcome, Pam.
Thank you, Nadja. It's nice to be here.
I understand you have a pretty significant role in training people in the community, people who work at the Institute, and going into the public schools to help. So what drew you into this? What made you interested in this kind of work?
Well, I was a very young parent, and so I think I was introduced to the difficult job of raising children in this culture of disrespect and violence that we live in the United States right now, and went from being an at-home mom into education and eventually prevention. My first job was working in an EDBD, emotionally disturbed behavioral disordered classroom, where actually I found that the human contact that we were allowed to have in that special education classroom was different than in classrooms where one teacher had 25 or 30 kids. We really had a family component. We had a smaller classroom that we were really able to get to know the kids. And I thought that was key, and I wanted to kind of do my own study and practice into looking at that and how we could expand that. And I found that in the prevention field. And so for the past 30 years, I've been working in prevention of some kind, violence prevention, substance abuse prevention, HIV/AIDS prevention, teen pregnancy prevention. As I usually say, you name a social ill and I've tried to prevent it.
And you can prevent it. Well, we'll call
I'm
on
not
you.
Sure I can, but I try.
You try.
I try.
Well, you certainly bring a lot of experience to the Institute. And just prior to your joining us on the set, Teny and I were talking about the street workers. Mm. And so I'm going to go back to Teny about to talk a little bit about that and then how that connects to the system of justice for kids, you know, youth, juvenile justice system, and the schools. Mm-hmm. So feel free to jump in or just wait until we just kind of segue into that. So let's start with talking again about the street workers and how you're really fulfilling your philosophy.
Well, the street workers, in a way, are an embodiment of nonviolence. They practice it on the street. They practice it in schools. They've been there, done that sort of a thing. But they committed their life to nonviolence, and they try and make young people not repeat the mistakes they have done. So they are sort of the daily practical steps of nonviolence. We teach the principles, we teach the steps of nonviolence. Where the training comes into role, really that's the immunization. Trying early on in third grade and up to start really saying conflicts are normal, but let's try and work on them in a way that isn't violent. And looking at what is nonviolent, what is it when you're angry with yourself, etc. And that's where really the training component is really in the long term the real solution.
Mm-hmm. Now, before we go right into the schools, how about working with the justice system? Do you have a connection to the police?
Or? We do. We have a connection to the courts, to the Attorney General's office, to the police, etc. I think the chief of police in Providence says it best. He says, I'm the second best alternative. I'd rather not arrest those kids.
Oh.
I'd rather the society invests in kids, in schools, in after school, that they don't end up running into my officers.
Mm-hmm. Well, in the schools, as Teny said, this is where he'd like to see, we all would like to see the prevention begin. Mm. So can you tell us a little bit about your program and why we're seeing, maybe before we talk about your program, why are we actually seeing so much violence in the schools?
Mm. And I just want to add on to what Teny was mm-hmm. saying, too, about
yes.
the justice system, is that we also do nonviolence training with police recruits now.
Oh.
And also we're going into the prisons as well. One of the things that the Institute has just recently done is taken over the Rhode Island Victim Advocacy and Support Center. So we now really offer the continuum of care from
wonderful.
Trying to prevent conflict turning into violence in the first place to really caring and doing rehabilitation work for those violent offenders.
How very realistic.
Yes.
I mean, this is
mm-hmm.
the piecemeal thing that's gone on forever.
Right.
You know, just something in the schools. So tell us, though, why do you think so much, well, there's always been crime and violence, but
yeah.
why are we seeing so much in the schools?
And I think I would warn our audience against thinking that just because we've seen some really horrendous evidence of violence in the schools, especially you know, in the last couple of months with Virginia Tech tragedy and before that things like the Columbine tragedy, that we shouldn't, and how much attention the media gives to those things and picks it apart, you know, mm-hmm. detail by detail, so that it gets blown apart, you know, and every little piece of the shadow gets looked at. I think we need to balance that with an understanding of the good things that are happening, and that actually in many cases to number one look at the reality of the kids in the streets of urban areas especially who are getting killed, and not as much attention mm-hmm. gets given to them sometimes, especially when it happens one at a time or two at a time, as does these big tragedies that make the news and that are worthy, and whoever is making those decisions, for the news to chew on for days or weeks or months. So I just think that we need to make sure we look at the data about what's actually happening rather than what our perception is.
Mm-hmm.
And I
mm-hmm.
think that the media has a big role to play in that.
Mm-hmm. I'd like to interject here that I'm so thrilled to hear what you're saying. And yet right now in the schools, there's so much focus on passing a test.
Yes.
That curriculum has been so narrowed down.
Yeah.
So I'm really excited to hear, how do you work with the schools? Teachers feel they're already overburdened. So
they are.
Can you tell us How do you get into the
and
schools?
And I think so much of the cuts that have happened to education, especially over the last 5 or 6 years, have really been a disservice to students and faculty and administrators in the schools, because it has taken away that social network and those outlets that kids need to be creative. You know, one of the tools of nonviolence is creativity. The more creative we are, the better critical thinkers we are. Mm-hmm. The better critical thinkers we are, the more we know how to deal with conflict in healthy ways and not have it just go towards violence. One of the things I often say in the beginning of workshops, I bring out a toolbox, mm-hmm. and I say, we're hoping to, you know, introduce you to a lot of tools of nonviolence and peace building. If the only tool in your toolbox is a hammer, you tend to see every problem as a nail. Oh. And so you use that same tool over and over again. Mm-hmm. What we're introducing you to are a new range of tools for your toolbox.
Now, these, Teny, the wonderful concepts that I'm hearing here, is this something that is used just in the schools, or does the Institute use these toolboxes and these ideas elsewhere?
Absolutely. I mean, as Pam was just mentioning, we work with people who are incarcerated and with juveniles who are incarcerated. We would like to teach government officials. I mean, really, all of us in society make decisions every day that either a good decision or decisions that hurt people. There's a discussion now in the country about the environment. It is violent to destroy your own environment for the sake of your kids. I think now some conservatives and liberals are coming to the same agreement. We got to look after the house we all share.
Mm-hmm. Well, this is important too, and I wanted to make sure people, our audience, could see that these very same tools are used in a broad way.
Absolutely.
So can you
I don't think there's anyone who can't benefit from learning more about nonviolence. So faith communities ask us to come, and community groups and agencies, community organizations.
Well, can you give us a little description about how you might work with it within a school?
Mm-hmm. And I'll tell you that one of the things that's exciting about the 2007-2008 school year is that it has some interesting anniversaries about nonviolence. Number one, it's the 50th anniversary of the Little Rock Nine, the segregation of schools in the South. And I think what that will bring up, and what some schools are already looking at, making that kind of a focal point of their history and their whole school, looking at issues of segregation and racism and poverty and institutionalized versions of all of those things. So we're looking, where are we 50 years later from mm-hmm. that conversation that we had as a nation when that first happened? And then it's also the 10th anniversary of the season of for nonviolence, which is between January 4th and April 30th. Mm. It marks the time between the anniversaries of the death of Martin Luther King and the death of Mahatma Gandhi. Oh. And so this coming year will be the 40th anniversary of the death of Martin Luther King and the 60th anniversary of the death of Mahatma Gandhi. So we're hoping that...
What a wonderful opportunity for teaching nonviolence.
Absolutely.
Right.
It's,
so how would
it's
you
got
call?
History, it's
yeah.
got sociology,
excellent.
It's got all of the things in there. You can do math lessons in that and obviously reading.
Wonderful. I can tell you were a teacher, Pam. Good for you. Can you give me an example now? Say a third grade, you go into a school in an inner city and to a third grade. What do you do? Just go in and give a lecture? I'm sure that's not
no,
all of it.
Obviously not. I mean, obviously what we take into consideration are multiple intelligences and different learning styles and mm-hmm. teaching styles, just like education has been doing for decades. So what we make it fun.
You work with the children?
Absolutely.
Oh, good.
As well as the faculty before we go in to prep them for what it is that we're doing. But then we take the same basic steps and principles that we teach in a lot that is the foundation of our curriculum, but we bring it down to age-appropriate level for children, and they eat it up. I mean, mm-hmm. elementary school kids, mm-hmm. I know you've worked with them yourselves, mm-hmm. they are just sponges. They really want to learn, and when you talk about their social environment, mm-hmm. because they're so much open, they haven't been closed mm-hmm. down yet, and they're not quite as subject to peer pressure as their older brothers and sisters, they're open and they want to talk about these things. As Teny said, it's all about relationship.
Now, do you see the same kind of enthusiasm and response if you go to a high school?
I would say that's a much tougher audience. As a preventionist, I've always wanted to start as early as we can when they're still open to that. Mm-hmm. You know, what we know from the research is that you can intervene in violence in three ways, by giving the entire population some basic information and skills, by focusing in on at-risk, specifically at-risk students, mm-hmm. and then by also focusing on people that have already used violence in rehabilitating them. Mm-hmm. And the intervention and rehabilitation part, the street workers do wonderfully. And we're now adding a training component in the prison and in the training schools mm-hmm. in Rhode Island. The prevention part, the information, and that's the training part.
I really identify with you in terms of early intervention. However, in all my years of teaching, I kind of got a little discouraged with the fact that they would start every new program. Well, starting a new program
yeah.
in the first grade.
Mm-hmm.
We're starting a new program, and all those teachers would adjust to whatever was mm-hmm. coming. But the high schools were pretty much circa 1940.
Right.
Come in, listen to the teacher, take your test, get an F if you're a bad kid.
Right.
So we have 1 minute left. So what I guess my little interjection there is to say, what you say about relationships is so important in
it
the
is.
High school as well
it
as
is.
In prevention.
And one of the things we're hoping to do is to have an age a tiered peer helper program, so that the teenagers that we train in the high school can go in with us and help train the middle schoolers,
Excellent.
And the middle schoolers help train the elementary schoolers.
That's a great idea, because kids do respond to kids. And we have about 30 or 40 seconds left. And I'd just like to say to Teny, you can take your pick, or maybe get both. What your greatest accomplishment with nonviolence is, or your disappointment or frustration. I know it's a short 40 minutes, but seconds rather.
The excitement being really the support of people in Providence and beyond, and reducing the homicides, because knowing that a mother won't have to cry for the next 20 years is a big deal. The frustration or the challenges is really making sure that the school system will adopt again the nonviolence into their systems.
Thank you both very much. This has been so enlightening, and I hope you'll come back again.
Thank you, Nadia.
You're welcome.
Thank you.
In closing, we do recognize the great contributions to nonviolence that have been made by Gandhi and Martin Luther King, but now it's up to us. It seems to me that nonviolence must be part of our ongoing education conversation, which you know I call school talk.